There are many different approaches to ionize compounds in mass spectrometry. We're going to start here by talking about electron ionization, and it actually begins with this device right here. Actually, this is more of a homemade version, but I want to talk to you and show you about the electron beam. So how we generate the electron beam, the source of our ionization, is really as simple as like taking a light bulb filament and cracking the glass off of it. So usually in mass spec, it's not literally a light bulb, but the idea is the same. When the electrons, the current is passing through that wire and it's doing so high enough, there's sort of like boiling off of those electrons. This is the same process that happens inside of those old school TVs, the big fat ones. So like there's an electron beam and it's being directed at a screen, and you can kind of point that around to different dots on the screen, and that's what lights it up. And by the way, the glow that you're seeing in there, the electron beam would be invisible, but it's going through some gas, and that's why we see it as this laser-like type-looking beam. So now we're inside the mass spectrometer. So this is the ionization source, and you can see our filament is right up there. The electrons are going to come off of that filament, but we want them to guide into a specific location. So that's why we've got the plate down at the bottom, and we're going to apply a voltage to that. So electrons are negative, the plate is positive, so I think the electrons should head downhill. And you can see that they're moving around with a certain speed. So that speed depends on the voltage that we're applying to it. If I want the electrons to move with a little bit more kick to them, I'll increase the voltage. And you see, boom, these electrons, they're really beaming through there now. So if that were to collide into a molecule, there'd be more energy involved in that collision. So with electron ionization, we usually set the voltage to 70 volts, and that's what we get this 70 electron volt. I'll talk to you about that in a second. So we've defined the energy of our electron beam. Now the ions need to get in there somewhere. Usually with this type of ionization source, this is like the coupling of gas chromatography to mass spec. So you can imagine the tube up there is basically just like the end of our GC column. This is sort of pointing straight in. So like compounds are coming out of that tube and they're gonna sort of fill up this space. Now keep in mind that right at this moment, those compounds don't have any charge. So I can actually turn on the voltage and nothing's gonna happen, right? The voltage is there, it'll kick these ions out into whatever mass analyzer we have the moment that they get ionized. So the ionization will take place once these compounds spread out and go across that electron beam. So let's just take one of them, it's crossed the electron beam, an electron has collided with that molecule with a reasonable amount of energy. So what it'll do is it'll take that electron from our molecule and it'll like knock it off. So as soon as that happens, it creates the positive charge, and the moment that that happens, the ion is going to accelerate out of this ion source and into our mass analyzer. So just as a summary here, we can imagine writing a reaction for that. So we have our molecule, it collides with an electron, and it ends up producing the molecular ion M plus dot that's got this free electron unpaired, and of course the two electrons because one is knocked off. That's the thing that we're interested in, and that's what's heading out that way. So now let's ask the question, like, how much energy does this take? Well, take the simplest model, a Bohr model of a hydrogen atom. So you got a proton and an electron floating around it. I know it doesn't really look like that, but like, let's just say that it does. So we have an electron that bangs into the hydrogen atom, and it promotes that electron to like the N equals infinity orbit. In other words, we've gone through the first ionization potential. So we can calculate exactly how much energy that takes. I won't take you through the calculation, but we know this like from first year chemistry. You can calculate about 1300 kilojoules per mole. Now, mass spectrometry doesn't like to talk in moles because we don't usually have that amount of material. We only have like one molecule. So we can convert that energy from kilojoules per mole to a different unit. So, you know, go online, take your favorite energy conversion unit factor, and we can see that we get about 13-14 electron volts. Or another way of saying that, one electron volt is about 96 kilojoules per mole, just to get familiar with these units. So that's the energy that it takes for hydrogen, but what about different molecules? Well, actually, you could go through a very long list, and for the most part, it's ballpark about the same. If anything, it's a little bit less. So you can see the ionization energy for these various compounds ranges in the 10-12 kind of range. Generally, when you have free electrons, when you have like a lone pair, when you have pi bonds, it makes it easier to ionize your compound. So now let's ask, what energy should we pick? I mean, based on all of these, let's make sure that it's like at least that much. If you don't have that much energy, you're not gonna have enough to ionize your compound. So we should pick at least that much energy. And in fact, the number that we pick is like surprisingly high. We tend to pick 70 electron volts, more than enough to ionize everything. So here's the proof as to why. The simple answer is because 70 electron volts is better than any other voltage. The plot that you see here is called the ionization cross-section, and that's basically what are the odds that the compound get ionized as a function of the electron volts over here. So the higher your signal, the better the odds are. So we're looking at data here that was just recently published, so it's for the compound benzene, but every molecule looks almost the same. And you can see that the theoretical model and the experimental model, they match very closely at, you know, 70 electron volts. So that's why we want to pick this sort of maximum ionization efficiency. Now, to really get down to it, there's like two reasons that we want to pick that specific voltage. One is for quantitative analysis. So not only do we want to get like the most ionization that we can get, but we want it to be consistent as well. We don't want the sample signals to change because of our mass spectrometer. We want it to change with concentration. So by picking 70 electron volts, things are pretty stable at that range. So it's a nice plateau on the top of the curve. The second reason comes down to qualitative analysis. So that's probably even more important, more the common use of why we do GCMS, is to be able to identify different unknowns. Now, how does that happen? Well, quite simply, we have a lot of energy. Electron ionization is called a hard ionization technique. So when you take all that energy and you import it into a molecule, what's going to happen with the rest? That's about it. Fragments all over the place, right? So there's more than enough energy to ionize the molecule, enough to spare to basically blow your molecule to bits. So you're going to generate fragments. And these are the things that we're going to use to identify our different compounds. These fragments are like fingerprints. They tell us what we have. I think we can still tell that that's a garbage truck. Anyway. So I'll just show you a useful tool here. So you go online, you can type in the NIST database, so the National Institute of Standards and Technology. And basically this is like a depository of all things chemistry. So you can get all kinds of information like the UV spectra, IR spectra, NMR, all this kind of stuff. So you just type in your favorite molecule and you go hunting. Somewhere on that list, there should be mass spec data. When we look at this, we're looking at EI, electron ionization mass spec. So there's a fragment spectrum for benzene. Let's look at a different compound, like, I don't know, acetone over here, and we can scroll through the list as well and once again come up with a fragmentation spectrum, EIMS. That's what acetone looks like. And finally, let's pick the last one here. I'll just spend a little bit more time talking about it because I know this is going through quickly. Diethyl ether, and here's the mass spectrum. And what you're looking at are a bunch of fragment ions. So there's the structure of diethyl ether, and you can calculate carbon, hydrogen, you can come up with the mass. It's just a nominal mass, but it's about 74. And you can see the ion at M over Z 74. Of course, there's one at 75 as well. So what's that from? Yeah, it's from the carbon 13 isotopes. It's the lower ones that we're now interested in. So the pieces, the smaller fragments that come from it. There's a lot of information in that because when you start doing the math and adding up, you know, what are the differences between these compounds, it becomes pretty obvious where these things might have originated from. So how do you lose 15? How do you lose 29? It's a loss of a methyl group, CH3. It's a loss of an ethyl group, CH3, CH2. So all of that information comes together. Now you could spend all kinds of time trying to interpret these things, but you know, sometimes people get lazy. So let's just have a computer do it for us. Let's just say that I ran an unknown molecule. I have no idea what it is, but this is the spectrum that came up on my computer after my mass spec did the analysis. Well, the computer or another mass spectrometer has already recorded it. You saw that I pulled out that spectrum from a database. That database is thousands upon thousands of compounds. So you're just going to let the computer say, yeah, it looks same to me. So perfect match, and the computer will identify in an instant click of a button, and it tells you exactly what your unknown compound is. Now, one question you might be asking is, how does this fragmentation occur? So if you think about it, in order for a compound to get ionized, it has to start somewhere. An electron is removed. Why is it that the entire molecule seems to break apart through that process of ionization? Well, theories have been put together on that. So this one here is one that's kind of synonymous with EI mass spec. It's called the quasi-equilibrium theory. And what you're looking at over here is the slow vibrations of the molecular bonds of our compound compared to the really fast ionization of our ion. So the electron is beaming in there way quicker than the vibrations are. So the ionization is instant, if you will. And let's look at that in terms of a molecule. Well, you can think of those lone pairs on the oxygen. That corresponds to the electron that we're likely going to lose. And as soon as that happens, that energy might be kind of localized in that region of the molecule, but it will distribute itself like nice and easily over the rest of the molecule. It does this before the molecule has a chance to break down. And at this point, the energy can sort of move its way into any bond it wants, and then the molecule cracks anywhere as it wants to be. So electron ionization has the benefit of generating fragments, and we use those fragments to identify compounds. But at the same time, that could be a disadvantage, especially when you've broken the molecule down so much that you actually don't even know what the original mass is supposed to be. So what we want are what we would call softer ionization techniques, a little bit less energy, a little bit less fragmentation. So we can do this very easily by just doing a small modification to our electron ionization source. This one's called chemical ionization. So same process as before, we still have GCMS, we still have the electron beam moving around at 70 electron volts, and a molecule goes into the system. But before that happens, what I've done now is I've added another port, and I've introduced something else. So not only does our analyte go into this system, but there's going to be like a background of what we call a reagent gas. So it could be methane, it could be nitrogen, it could be ammonia, all kinds of different things that we could use. So in this example here, we have methane. And yeah, let's say there's like way more methane than there is the compound that we're interested in. So what's going to be ionized? Well, more than likely, it's going to be the background gas that hits that electron beam first. So here you see the ionization of methane. And let's think about this. The only place that a single electron could be lost is through one of those sigma bonds. So that has basically weakened one of these bonds, a CH bond, to the point that it could bump into another compound of methane and make this the super acid, let's say, CH5+. That's an acidic compound. And if it's that acidic, well, I mean, what's stopping it from bumping into our molecule and through a proton transfer reaction, it can protonate our compound. So this is a different form of ionization. Instead of going M plus dot, we're going M plus H. It's kind of like electrospray. Well, yeah, it is kind of like electrospray, but it happens in the gas phase. And it happens using the EI source. I think that's one of the most important facts about EI is that our compounds begin in the gas phase. If you can't put your compound in the gas phase, good luck doing electron ionization with it, because like that's where the whole process begins. Now, believe it or not, chemical ionization is closer to electrospray than you can imagine. The electrospray source can actually be modified and turn it into a chemical ionization source. We call that APCI, atmospheric pressure chemical ionization. One more acronym for you to learn. So basically we're ionizing the gas, the reagent gas, in other words, the air, and then the ionized air is what's being used to ionize our compound. Where have I seen ionization air before? It just reminds me of something.
If you will not be turned, you will be destroyed.
Right. Lightning bolts. That's what I was thinking of. Anyway, what's the difference between EI and CI? Well, like I said, it comes down to how much energy is involved and how much fragmentation is formed. Yes, there is that extra mass. So CI gives us M plus H, whereas EI gives us M plus dot. So you're seeing this mass difference of one across the board. But the other thing you're noticing here is that we generate more fragments with EI. So much so that we've lost the molecular ion, it's disappeared, where we can see the molecular ion in CI. So sometimes there are advantages of CI over EI. I guess the easiest thing is that they're literally the same source. So you can just sort of flip a switch and turn it from one to the other. Anyway, that's all I've got for you on electron ionization. So we'll see you in the next one.